Hi y'all. So today we're going to be discussing geologic time and relative dating. If you don't know what relative dating is, we're going to get into it. Basically, there are two main ways to determine the age of rocks. We use either relative or absolute dating methods. And we'll talk about absolute dating next time. So this time we'll discuss both geologic time and relative dating techniques. So let's get started. You can see here a picture of the time scale. This is the geologic time scale, guys. This is the Geologic Society of America, or GSA, version, but there are many versions. I like this one because it's colorful. So how you can read this, I know it looks like a lot right now, but basically this is all of Earth's history based on our rock record, meaning we've gone and looked at rocks that are aged throughout Earth's history from 4.5 billion years ago to now, and we've organized them into different formations or units of rock that are distinguished from each other by different characteristics, like lithology, fossils. We'll talk about what that means, but basically that's how we came up with the different categories. And in this time scale, you can see that the age is shown in the very left column of each main column. That left column says age, and then it says ma. Ma just means millions of years. So that's a unit of age. And so all these numbers are in millions of years. You know, you see like 25 million years ago. So that's the age in millions of years. And so you can see the time scale goes all the way back. Well, you can't see the very bottom because it cut off in the picture, but it goes back to 4.5 billion years ago at the beginning of the Hadean. I mean, that is all the way on the bottom right of that figure. So it starts at the bottom right and goes up from the Hadean to the Archean to the Proterozoic, and then goes back down. You see that where it says Cambrian, if you go one more column to the left, and then it goes up to Permian. And then it goes back down to Triassic, and then up to Cretaceous, and then back down to Paleogene, and then up to Neogene. And that is how you can read this timescale. And basically each main column, those color-coded columns, one with the headings, those are the Precambrian, then the Paleozoic, then the Mesozoic, and the Cenozoic. And the Precambrian is broken up into three different eons. An eon is the largest time unit that we'll see. It's kind of weird though, because the Precambrian designates all three of those eons, but it's also an eon. Don't think about it too long. The Precambrian consists of eons, Hadean, Archean, and Proterozoic. Then you can break that down into eras. Then you can break those down into periods. And that's so long and time ago that you can't really break the periods down into epochs and ages like we'll see in the rest of the eras. But you get the gist. Then from the Precambrian, we go into the Paleozoic, Mesozoic, and Cenozoic. And all of those eras, are designated within the Phanerozoic eon. So it's Precambrian, which is composed of Hadean, Archean, and Proterozoic eons. And then from those, it goes to the Phanerozoic eon. That eon is composed of the Paleozoic, Mesozoic, and Cenozoic eras. So eon, era, period, and then epoch and age. The Paleozoic is broken up into the Cambrian, Ordovician, Silurian, Devonian, Carboniferous, and Permian periods. These periods can be further broken down into epochs or epochs, whatever you want to pronounce it. And then those epochs can be broken down into ages. And those are typically only used by the people that are studying a very specific time in Earth's history. So don't worry about the ages or even the epochs. Focus on periods are really important. And then obviously eras and eons. Moving on to the Mesozoic, you can see that we have the Triassic, Jurassic, and Cretaceous periods. Those can be broken down further into epochs and ages. And then moving on to the Cenozoic, we have the Paleogene and Neogene periods. But in the Cenozoic, we typically use epochs because so much more is known about more recent rocks because we have so much more rocks in recent time than we have from the Precambrian because those have been recycled or destroyed by erosion or whatever it might be. So we have way more in the Cenozoic rock record than we do the others. So we use epochs because we can get more specific there. We have more information. So with the epochs of the Cenozoic, we have the Paleocene, Eocene, and Oligocene for the Paleogene period. And then the epochs for the Neogene period are the Miocene and Pliocene. Then the last period is the Quaternary, and that's what we are in right now. And you can break that up into the Pleistocene and Holocene epochs. And now some people are saying that we're in a new epoch that is the Anthropocene, but I don't know how scientific that is. So we're in the Holocene. We'll just stick with that. Anyway, that's how you can break down the categories of the timescale with my later episodes that are going to be over exactly what happened or what evolved on Earth in the specific eons and eras and periods of Earth's history. You'll get a lot more used to hearing these time categories stated in sentences and kind of understand what happened during them, and that way you'll remember it more. But for now, that's all you really need to know, how to designate each time category and what they mean, and that's enough for now. So let's move on to how to think about geologic time. In this slide, we can tell, holy crap, we're a young species. So for example, this is a circular geologic time scale. This shows how long major things have been around. For example, photosynthesis started over 3 billion years ago, and you can see that on the right side in the Archean eon. And if you go forward, you can see when the great oxidation event occurred. We're going to be talking about this for a whole episode. It's so important and awesome. But the great oxidation event, basically it says here at the bottom, when the atmosphere became oxygen rich, that's a really important time. And that was around 2.4 to 2.1 billion years ago. And that's in the Proterozoic eon. And then moving forward, you can see when dinosaurs came around and then died out in the Mesozoic, almost at the very end of the time scale compared to the rest of the time. And then you can see, well, let me take that back. You can't see really well where the first hominins came in, and that's the lineage that we came from. So it's kind of crazy how young of a species, and not only species, but family we are. And we'll talk about the different categories of taxonomy in later episodes, but my goodness, we are young. And I emphasize this by another cool fact, and that is, we are so young that if you put the time scale on a 12-hour clock, humans wouldn't even show up into the last 2 seconds. The last 2 seconds, guys. It's just crazy. I emphasize this because it's so hard to imagine how long Earth's history is. And it really is, because you can see that the Hadean, Archean, and the Proterozoic, which is only that first column on the last picture, if you go here, that's just the Precambrian. That consists of the majority of Earth's history. You can see that with this circle graph. That's why I like the circle graph, but it's also like mind-blowing. Most of Earth's history was just magma at the beginning, then an ocean, then life. This life was not what most of us think as life. It was just single cellular organisms, microbes and whatnot, for a long time. Even the photosynthesizers, microbes. They were not plants yet. They were plants way later. So we all are very young, even the dinosaurs. They're still here as birds, and they're still young compared to the rest of Earth's history. So now getting into the difference between relative and absolute age. Relative age is how we determine a rock's age using relative dating or relative techniques, meaning relative to this rock is older. And a lot of times that's easy because you can walk up to an outcrop where there's a few layers and you can say, well, that layer on the bottom should be older than the layer on the top because, you know, gravity. But actually, we have a principle for this, and we're going to go over principles of relative dating in the next slide. And the people that made these wonderful principles that are very useful for relative dating in geology are Nicholas Steno, James Hutton, William Smith, and George Cuvier. And these are going to be the principles of relative dating that set the stage for allowing us to date rocks, because relative dating came along way before absolute dating, which we'll talk about in the next episode. But as you can see here, it involves radiometric dating. So it sounds a little bit more quantitative, which it is, but relative dating is how we made the geologic timescale. So let's see how it works. The principles include the principle of original horizontality, which just means that all strata were horizontal when they formed. Strata are just layers of rocks. And so if you come up to an outcrop where there's layers that are not horizontal, they're layered, but they're tilted or folded or something, then that means that that tilting and folding must have happened after they were deposited. Superposition, this principle states, like I said earlier, if you see layers of a rock, the older one is the one on the bottom, the younger one is the one on the top. And this seems very simple, but someone did have to come along and say it and actually put it in writing, and now we can use it. And that person was Nicholas Steno in the 1600s. And you can see this principle here in these strata in the picture to the right. You can see the younger ones are on the top. And then principle of lateral continuity, which you can also see in this picture, is basically saying that sediment rains down or gets deposited in a way that is laterally continuous. So, you know, if you have this canyon type erosion where you have these layers in this one pillar of rock and then a pillar over there, but you can't see the in between, you can infer that there was rock in between, if those layers look the same and like they match up. It's typically pretty self-explanatory as well, but again, you had to come along and say it. And these are three principles that Steno has blessed us with and we can use now to relatively date rocks. Additionally, the principle of intrusive relationships states that igneous rocks that intrude original sediment are younger than those original rocks. And we can tell things like this because typically those intrusions are cross-cutting layers, and that goes into the principle of cross-cutting. Principle of cross-cutting relations states that a structure such as a fault that cuts across layers is also younger than those original sediments. So the intrusive relations and cross-cutting relations I find really similar. They're basically if an intrusion is cross-cutting or a fault is cross-cutting the original strata, and you can see that with your eyes, then you know that that intrusion or fault or whatever is younger. And so they're very similar. Cross-cutting just typically refers to faults. Intrusive relations just typically refers to igneous intrusions because magma is the only thing that causes like dikes and sills to come up and intrude original sediment. So the last one on this slide, the principle of inclusion, states that fragments from one body of rock found in a second body are older than that second body, meaning if you look at this rock that has all the clasts that we know is conglomerate from previous episodes, that these clasts are from sediment that was eroded and weathered from something else that then got re-cemented together into a new rock, and the cement part is the matrix, and these clasts are older than the matrix because they were around and then they got cemented together by new or younger cement. So that is the relative date between those clasts and the younger matrix. That is it for relative dating principles. There are more important concepts to know. For example, unconformities. These are really important for relative dating because unconformities represent surfaces of non-deposition or erosion. These are important because you can't just go and say this stratum was deposited and then this one was. Because maybe if there's an erosional surface there, there was time in between there that could be short, it could be super long, it could be millions, billions of years. We don't know until we do some further investigation, which is what unconformities call for. And we can recognize unconformities by looking at the surfaces between rock layers or boundaries. And three main types of unconformities include angular unconformities, nonconformities, and disconformities. Angular unconformities are probably the easiest to recognize. You can see here on the left, basically, if layers are angled or they were folded somehow and then erosion occurred, cuts a straight line over that angular surface, and then more sediment was deposited on that, you can tell there was erosion and missing time because clearly where the layers are angled, you can't see the top of that fold, so something was cut off. A bunch of time there was just cut right off, and then more layers were deposited, so you have a lot of missing time there. That is the easiest to recognize because the angular unconformity has angular layers right underneath it and cuts them off. So that's an angular unconformity. Moving on to a nonconformity. Nonconformities separate metamorphic or igneous rock from younger sedimentary rock. If sedimentary rocks are deposited right on top of some metamorphic or igneous rocks, that's a nonconformity. And you can tell there's missing time there because sedimentary rocks aren't necessarily being deposited or formed where igneous and metamorphic rocks are formed. Clearly. So we know there's missing time there, and igneous and metamorphic rocks were there, and then a bunch of erosion occurred, or uplift and erosion, or whatever it might have been, and then sedimentary layers got deposited on top way later. And then the disconformity might be the most inconspicuous one, meaning it's harder to tell, but basically this is just saying that there's an erosional surface in between two layers of strata. They can be sedimentary. We just have to be able to tell that erosion occurred. So there's no rock type to tell us the answer. There's no angularity to tell us the answer. We just have to be able to tell that erosion occurred. Sometimes we can tell this by rock type once you go further into detail. If you say, okay, both of these are sedimentary, but let's go into more detail. Is this a limestone? Is this a sandstone? What might have happened? What's the surface characteristics? So all of these things can help you decide whether that boundary between those two rocks is an erosional surface or not. Those are the three types of unconformities. Moving on, this is an exercise for you guys to think about before I tell you the answer. So you can pause the video, but I'm going to ask you a question and you have to think about it. Pause if you need to, because I'm going to say the answer right after I ask the question. What I'm going to ask you first is, what do you think the oldest layer of rock here is? This is basically a cross-section of rock layers, and they're just color-coded for our ease. And so the oldest rock layer in this sediment should be A. Next, the layer that deposited after that was B. The next layer to be deposited was C. Next, this one's tricky. You know dikes and sills are igneous. So igneous might be younger. So the next one is E. Now before I move on, let me explain why that this is E. The igneous sill D doesn't come right after layer C or 3. I put the 3 over the C. Because you can see that it incorporated material from both layer C and E, which is the blue and the yellow. This indicates that it started intruding after those layers were deposited, and it squeezed in between the surface in between those rock layers, and it picked up this material because obviously this rock didn't want to move very easily, so if some of it broke off and went into the igneous sill, and that's what we see here. And so that's how we know that this D igneous sill layer is younger. So that's the next one that happened after the blue and yellow deposited. Next, we know that this F igneous dike deposited after all of these angled layers here because it cuts across all of them. We can see it with our eye. And we know that this F igneous dike is cut off by G, meaning that we had the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and igneous dike 6 deposit and then erode away, because we can see clearly something folded the layers, and then the sill came in, and then the dike came in, and then there was erosion to take off the top of that fold. Now they're just angular layers, and that's an angular unconformity that is already labeled there for you that designates the bottom of layer G, and that is our next layer that deposited. After G, it gets pretty simple. You have H, I, J, K. So then you have one more 12. Obviously, there's no more layers, but this is ordering geologic events. So we also have to think about events that aren't necessarily rock deposition. So the last event is 12, erosion. And this is important to note that you're ordering geologic events, not just rock layers, geologic events. So like the unconformity, actually, you should have ordered that as well, meaning I should have, but I didn't. I forgot, but basically that might have been 7, and then G would have been 8, so there shouldn't necessarily be 13 events. I messed up, but you get where I'm going. Next, we're going to discuss, what is the geologic timescale based on? We see that we have really specific numbers here, but those only came after the timescale was really in place. We built the timescale on relative dating and fossils. We only used absolute dating later when we already had the designated categories of time all figured out. And then we came in and absolutely dated a lot of the rock layers that define certain boundaries of time. That's how we came up with the more specific numbers. But originally we did build a timescale based off of relative dating and fossils. And when you're dating things relatively with fossils, it's called biostratigraphy. And so this is the principle of fossil succession, we didn't talk about earlier because it's so different. I wanted a whole slide for it by itself. But basically, this principle is used in biostratigraphy where you date the strata based on biology or the fossil content. So it makes perfect sense that it's called biostratigraphy. And what you can see here in this strat column, this is called a stratigraphic column, by the way, you can see that the layers of rock have different fossils in them. And based on the fossils in the certain layers, we can say this is the distinguished layer relative to this one. We know this one's older, this one's younger, and this fossil seems to be here in this one, but not in this one. So maybe that organism went extinct. And the more diverse fossils that you can use to implement biostratigraphy, the more accurate you can be, and the more distinguishable layers or time periods you can identify. So that's it for relative dating. Remember, we learned about the principles of original horizontality, superposition, lateral continuity, intrusive relations, cross-cutting relations, inclusions, and fossil succession. So I hope you remember all of those principles, and if you need to go back and watch this again, feel free. I also hope you learned something about how to use each one of those principles when we are relatively dating rocks. I hope the exercise that we did with the cross-section was helpful. helpful, and I hope you understand the difference between ordering rock layers and geologic event. And I also hope that you come back next time to learn about absolute dating, because I am a geochemist and I'm in love with isotopes because they're amazing and they could tell us so much, and that is what absolute dating is about. So please join me for that episode. I can't wait to see you all there, and thank you so much for watching. Bye.